friends, I have always taken privilege in stating that the space law is going to be one of the most significant laws in the 21st century. There are so much of developments which are taking place in the field of the space activities as well as in space law in the current era that one cannot imagine. Therefore, I would try to put forward the ambit of the space law in this particular lecture in two parts. First of all, I'll be discussing about the theoretical underpinnings in this part one. And in part two, I'll be discussing about the practical significance of space law by highlighting different issues which have cropped up over the period of time. To start with, entry of Sputnik into the outer space in 1957 has resulted in the beginning of a new era, which is known as the space age. Both Soviet Union as well as the United States were heavily involved in a kind of a race for the purpose of establishing a space hegemony. Of course, it has resulted in many beneficial developments. We had the achievements in terms of the first human presence in outer space in the form of Yuri Gagarin. Then there have been landings on the moon, initially the hard landing, then the soft landing of the spacecraft, and finally even the human landing, which took place in 1969. At the same point of time, outer space has also been extensively used for different commercial purposes. We are having use of the space technology in terms of the telecommunication, direct television broadcasting, in terms of telemedicine, teleeducation, even the collection of the solar energy, resource exploitation research, so on and so forth. At the same point of time, outer space is also being used for the purpose of military advantage. So that's how, over the period of time, a lot of developments have taken place in the field of the space activities. Friends, along with the state activities in outer space, we can also see that the private players have come into picture, and in this modern period of time, private players are also carrying on extensive activities in the outer space. But when the Sputnik entered into the outer space in 1957, it was just the beginning of the entire era. And there were two questions which cropped up predominantly in the international level. First was how to define or demarcate the outer space. And second was, what is the law applicable in outer space? Let me just briefly touch upon these two issues before going forward with the fundamental principles which are governing the outer space activities. Now, definition and demarcation was found very significant, especially because of the reason that the law governing airspace was considered to be something different from the law governing outer space. Since the beginning of the space activities, the international community was aware of the fact that outer space should be subject to a different law when compared to that of airspace. This is because airspace is governed by the principle of sovereignty, but whereas the outer space is governed by the principle of freedom. When the concepts applicable to these two regions themselves are entirely different, the laws which are governing these two regions are also supposed to be different, was known to the international community. So an attempt was made for the purpose of defining and demarcating the outer space from the airspace. Different theories came into existence: gravitational force theory, theory of satellite orbit, then atmospheric theories, Kármán line theory, functional theories, different kind of theories have come into existence for the purpose of demarcating the outer space from airspace. But unfortunately, each theory had got its own limitations, and consequently, none of them could able to concretely determine the line of demarcation between the airspace and outer space. Finally, in the UN COPUS, United Nations Committee on Peaceful Uses of the Outer Space, there has been a decision by the member countries that definition of outer space is not something feasible, and it has to be decided on case-by-case basis what law has to be made applicable at what altitude. If the object is in, say, 80 kilometers or 100 kilometers above the Earth's surface, what law has to be made applicable? That has to be decided on case-by-case basis by the competent authority. That's what has been decided, and currently there is no clear-cut definition of outer space. And there is no line of demarcation which would distinguish the airspace from outer space. The second significant question stopped up at that particular point of time had been the law applicable in outer space. Should it be public international law, or should it be the domestic law of the state which is carrying on the activity in the outer space, or is there a situation that there is no law in outer space? That was a kind of a debate which originated in 1950s. During this time, a lateral shift from the air law to the outer space law also started to begin with the intervention of the United Nations for the lawmaking. UN General Assembly, to be more precise, started passing the resolutions governing the outer space activities since 1958 itself. There are some very, very significant resolutions passed by the UN General Assembly, and it also went on to establish the UN COPAS, United Nations Committee on the Peaceful Uses of the Outer Space, as one of the major organizations for the purpose of regulating the activities in outer space, and more particularly ensure that activities in outer space are carried on for the peaceful purposes. But in somewhere in the middle of 1960s, it was quite clear to the world community that the UN General Assembly resolutions are not sufficient for the purpose of regulating the activities in outer space. This is especially because of the reason that the UNGA resolutions are not binding on the states, and there was a requirement of hard law in the form of the treaties to govern the outer space activities. And this resulted in a second stage of development of space law. While the first stage has been the soft law in terms of the UN space treaty, so space resolution, UN General Assembly resolutions, the second stage of the development was found absolutely required. Starting from 1967, five major treaties were entered with respect to the space activities. First was the Outer Space Treaty 1967, which is considered to be the Magna Carta of the space law, outlining certain fundamental principles governing the space activities. Second, the Rescue Agreement of 1968, which is primarily for the purpose of rescuing the astronauts or the personnel, and also collection of the space objects in case of emergency and returning them back to the launching authority. Third was the Liability Convention 1972, which primarily fixes the liability for any damage caused out of the space activities. Fourth was the Registration Convention 1975, which is for the purpose of registration of the space object to ensure the transparency and also to make clear that actually to which state the space object belongs. Finally, in 1979, the Moon Agreement has been signed, especially for the purpose of regulating the activities on the Moon and other celestial bodies. This is a much more advanced regime, primarily to ensure that the activities in the celestial bodies are not actually contrary to the international law. It has to be within the four corners of the law. That's what has been ensured out of the Moon Agreement 1979. After 1979, the second stage of development took a kind of a halt. The treaties they started to stop, especially because the consensus which is required for the purpose of developing the treaties started to obliterate. As a consequence, we don't have any space treaty after 1979. Now, in order to ensure that the many, manifold areas which are developing in the space activities are not unregulated, for that particular purpose, UN General Assembly once again stepped in and it started to pass the set of principles governing those areas. You can find that three set of principles have come into existence. First was the 1982 set of principles on the direct television broadcasting. 1986 resolution on the remote sensing of the Earth from the outer space was the second set of resolution. And finally, we have the principles governing the use of nuclear power sources in the outer space, 1992. It is the third set of the principles with respect to the space activities. Apart from these set of principles, in 1996, a declaration was entered, especially for the purpose of ensuring that Article 1 of the Outer Space Treaty has been furthered and even the benefits would go to all the countries whenever the space activity has been carried out. Of course, the success of all these things are debatable. Scholars opine that actually the 1996 declaration did not result in doing much with respect to sharing of the benefits with the countries. Whatever it may be, there were three stages in the development of space law, starting with the UN General Assembly resolutions, which are soft laws, then the five treaties, and then finally the three set of principles. The third stage of development was in the form of three set of principles as well as the 1996 declaration. Now, if we look into all these developments in the international level, what is binding at present are only the five major space treaties, that too to the parties to the concerned the treaties. Apart from that, some of the principles are argued to be part of customary international law, and therefore they are binding on all the states. Now, let me tell you some of the fundamental principles which have been agreed, some of them as part of customary international law, and the remaining are part of the Outer Space Treaty, which is the most popular treaty amongst the five space treaties. I should tell you first that the very basis of development with respect to the outer space lawmaking has started in the Common Rights Regime. The belief was that outer space and celestial bodies belong to everyone, and precisely because of that reason, everyone should have certain rights in the outer space and celestial bodies. So that's why we should understand this background for the purpose of actually appreciating the different fundamental principles, whatever have come into existence over the period of time. Let me start with the first fundamental principle. That is the principle of province of all mankind. Article 1 of the Outer Space Treaty says that exploration and use of the outer space shall be carried on for the benefit and interest of all countries and shall be the province of all mankind. What does this mean? What is the meaning of the province of all mankind? You don't find the meaning in the Outer Space Treaty. In fact, when the space activity started, there were two Roman law concepts which were readily available for the purpose of application to the outer space. They were res nullius and res communis. Res nullius means something which does not belong to anyone, but whoever first gets a hold of that or whoever first claims a rights over it would be getting the property rights over the res nullius. Communis, on the other hand, is something which belongs to everyone, and everyone can make use of it, but nobody can claim property rights over it. Though it belongs to everyone, nobody can individually appropriate. Nobody can individually claim the property rights over those resources. But one of the unique features of the res communis is that whoever is making use of the res communis can make use of it. Others definitely cannot complain about the use. And at the same point of time, there is no obligation to share the benefit by the users. So that is one of the limitations of the res communis regime. So the drafters of the Outer Space Treaty thought that neither the res communis regime nor the res nullius regime would be suitable for application to the outer space. Because if it is res nullius, then probably the spacefaring nations like the USSR or United States could have claimed the rights over all the outer space as well as celestial bodies. All of the outer space and celestial bodies might belong to them. If it is res communis, then also there is a problem, because even though the res communis does not allow the individual property rights, still everyone can make use of it. US and USSR, being the developed countries having space technology, they could have used the entire outer space or celestial bodies or exploited the resources there, but they have no obligation to share the benefit. So therefore, at the end of the day, application of both res nullius as well as res communis would have resulted in creation of monopoly in favor of the spacefaring nations like USSR or the United States. So, because of this reason, the drafters of the Outer Space Treaty did not subscribe to res communis or the res nullius regime. Rather, they went ahead with the use of the expression province of all mankind. And Professor Carl Q. Crystal, he mentions in his treatise that province of all mankind is an advanced version of the res communis regime. It belongs to everyone, just like in res communis, the province of all mankind belongs to everyone. But he says that there should be an element of voluntary sharing of benefit, even though it is not mandatory sharing. But whoever is actually making use of these resources, whoever is getting benefit out of that, must acknowledge the fact that everyone else is also having the right in these resources. Therefore, whatever benefit they get, they should share it with others as well. That's what Professor Karl Q. Pistol basically speaks about the promise of all mankind. But unfortunately, in the absence of any concrete definition in the Outer Space Treaty, the developed countries have refused to accept such kind of a meaning to the promise of all mankind. And they've always said that promise of all mankind is a general expression in vague terms to say about rights of everyone. And there is no requirement of the kind of benefits out of the activities, whatever they have carried on. So the dilemma is still there, but one should appreciate that the promise of all mankind is a lateral thinking in the direction of ensuring that the rights of everyone is respected in the outer space and celestial bodies. The second fundamental principle, one of the most significant principles, is the principle of national non-appropriation. Article 2 of the Outer Space Treaty says that the outer space, including the moon and other celestial bodies, is not subject to the national appropriation by claim of sovereignty, use or occupation, or by any other means. So there is a clear-cut prohibition on the national appropriation. Now, this provision brings forward two questions. One, is it that Article 2 prohibits only national appropriation, or does it also prohibit the claim of sovereignty by the states? Some of the scholars have argued that Article 2 does not prohibit claim of sovereignty, but only when the claim of sovereignty amounts to national appropriation, that is prohibited under Article 2. But this seems to be self-contradictory, especially because of the reason that claim of sovereignty is nothing but claim of a kind of a monopoly, right? Somebody is actually, some state is ascertaining that actually it has a sovereignty over a particular region, and thereby it is trying to claim an exclusive right over that particular region. And if anyone else want to enter that particular region or territory, they would always expect that state to take permission before entering into that territory. Therefore, claim of sovereignty in some way or other leads to the national appropriation. But on the contrary, some elements of the sovereignty, like the right of self-defense, or maybe even the right of hot pursuit, this may be extendable to the outer space whenever the circumstances arise. But otherwise, mere claim of sovereignty straight away would contravene actually Article 2 of the Outer Space Treaty, and it's not permissible as it amounts to the national appropriation. Second question about Article 2. Whether Article 2 prohibits only the national appropriation, or does it also prohibit the individual appropriation? Can an individual claim the property rights over the celestial bodies, or maybe in outer space, some portions of the outer space? Though the states are prohibited explicitly under Article 2, what about the status of an individual? I should again say that Article 2 of the Outer Space Treaty not just prohibits the national appropriation, but also prohibits the individual appropriation. Of course, the drafters would not have intended to allow the individuals to claim the property rights by prohibiting the states to states from claiming the sovereignty or any other kind of a right over the outer space and celestial bodies. For the purpose of understanding this, we should also look into the system of allocation of property in both the common law system as well as the civil law system. If we look into the common law system, understanding is that state owns everything and it gives the license to the individual to enjoy the property. So the principle of eminent domain, wherein state has got the every right over the all property, has been clearly evident in the common law system. In the wake of this, a citizen from the common law system definitely cannot claim any kind of a property right over the outer space or celestial bodies, because the state itself does not own the outer space or celestial bodies. Once it does not own, it can't confer the property rights to the individual. In the civil law system, the property may exist independent of state rights. That is possible because actually allocation of the property in the civil law system is different from common law system. Because in civil law system, an individual would go and occupy a property which does not belong to anyone, or terra nullis or res nullis, and develops that particular property. the concerned state could recognize the right of that individual with respect to the labor, whatever he has put in the development of the property. So the property right is conferred on the basis of the development or on the basis of the labor, whatever has been put in by the individual for the development of the property. So in civil law system, there is no requirement of a state owning the property for the purpose of giving the recognition to the individual. But we should keep in mind that even in the civil law system, what is crucial is that the concerned property should not belong to anyone or terra nullis. It is not something which belongs to others. But whereas we have already discussed that the outer space and celestial bodies belong to everyone, the principle of province of all mankind, even though there is a debate about benefit sharing, still it is very clear that it is something which belongs to everyone and every country has accepted this. So given that factor, even a citizen from a civil law country cannot claim any kind of a property rights over the outer space and celestial bodies. So under Article 2, we should safely conclude that claim of sovereignty is prohibited and even the individual appropriation is prohibited within the ambit of Article 2 of the outer space. The third fundamental principle governing the outer space is the freedom of exploration, use and scientific investigation. Again, Article 1 of the Outer Space Treaty says that every state shall have the freedom of exploration, use and scientific investigation in outer space. But we should keep in mind that it does not give the freedom of exploitation of resources or maybe any other kind of exploitation on the outer space or celestial bodies has not been subject to the freedom under Article 1. It only confers the freedom for exploration, use and scientific investigation. And more importantly, this freedom is not unbridled freedom. It is subject to the restrictions because this freedom is available to all the countries. And consequently, when some country is exercising this particular freedom, it should also respect the right of other countries while exercising this freedom. That's why it's not unbridled, it is subject to the limitations, and even the other principles, whatever has been enshrined under the space treaties, need to be respected while carrying on or while exercising this freedom of the exploration, use or scientific investigation. The next fundamental principle is the concept of common heritage of mankind. This is a concept which has been enshrined under Article 11 of the Moon Agreement. In fact, the CHM or the Common Heritage of Mankind has got the roots in Law of the Sea. The Malta's representative to the United Nations, Arvid Pardo, he basically advocated for the Common Heritage of Mankind to be made applicable to the deep seabed as well as the subsoil in the Law of the Sea regime development. If we look into the proposal of Arvid Pardo as well as actually in the Law of the Sea Convention, we can find that there are five basic elements of the Common Heritage of Mankind. First, prohibition on individual appropriation or the private appropriation. Second, presence of a strong international management system. There should be a strong international management system to manage the common heritage of mankind as well as to supervise the activities therein. Third, mandatory equitable sharing of the benefits. It's not optional. Unlike the province of all mankind, wherein only voluntary sharing has been proposed, in the common heritage of mankind, it's a mandatory sharing of the benefit by whoever who is exploiting the common heritage of mankind. Fourth, interestingly, the common heritage of mankind also speaks about sustainable development. There's a requirement of preservation of those resources which are declared as the common heritage of mankind for the future generation. So rights of the future generation has to be respected while carrying on activities in the CHM. Finally, the common heritage of mankind has to be used only for the peaceful purposes. So it should be used only for peaceful, not for aggressive military uses. So these are the fundamental principles or fundamental elements of the concept of common heritage of mankind. If we look into Article 11 of the Moon Agreement, the CHM has been imbibed in such a strong way that the activities in the celestial bodies, because the Moon Agreement is applicable only to the Moon and other celestial bodies, right? So the activities in the Moon and other celestial bodies are to be regulated in such a fashion that without the sharing of the benefit with others or maybe whoever is having interest in those resources, the exploitation of the resources is not permissible. But unfortunately, by virtue of all these obligations, the developed countries have not signed and ratified the Moon Agreement. Majority of the countries in the world did not ratify. Only 19 states have signed and ratified the Moon Agreement. And that too, many of them are not even the spacefaring nation. So consequently, the common knowledge of mankind, even though it's one of the celebrated concepts, especially in terms of the common rights regime, unfortunately has not got much practical significance in the absence of ratification by major spacefaring countries. We have the principle in terms of the jurisdiction and control. Article 8 of the Outer Space Treaty states that the state of registry shall retain the jurisdiction and control over the space objects and the personnel thereof. So it says state of registry shall retain the jurisdiction and control over the space object as well as the personnel thereof. It's an interesting provision, especially because of two reasons. One, it is a kind of a combination of rights and obligations. Exercise of a jurisdiction and control over the space object, of course, it's a matter of a right. But at the same point of time, if we look into the wordings of Article 8, it says that the states shall retain the jurisdiction and control. So it indicates a kind of an obligation. They have an obligation to retain jurisdiction and control also under Article 8 of the Outer Space Treaty. Second important aspect is that Article 8 combines two types of jurisdiction. On the one hand, it speaks about jurisdiction over the space objects. In other words, quasi-territorial jurisdiction. On the other hand, it also speaks about the jurisdiction over the personnel thereof. It is not personnel thereon. It is not just the people who are on board the space object. Even if actually they are outside the space object, still they are subject to the jurisdiction of the state of registry. In other words, if an astronaut is doing a spacewalk, or if he's on the moon or any other celestial body, still he is subject to the jurisdiction of the state of registry. So, second limb is the personal jurisdiction. Article 8 combines the quasi-territorial jurisdiction with the personal jurisdiction without creating any hierarchy. So that is another salient feature of Article 8 of the Outer Space Treaty. It might be problematic, especially in the circumstances wherein an astronaut has been launched from the space object of country A. Hypothetically, country A has registered the space object, which has launched the astronaut into the outer space. And then he enters into the International Space Station, which might belong to country B. International Space Station might have been registered in country B. After entering therein, he commits a particular wrong or does a particular activity. And if this comes before the court of law for the purpose of determination, any wrong, whatever has been committed. Now the question is, which court should exercise the jurisdiction? Should it be state A's courts or should it be state B's courts? If we go by Article 8, there is a possibility of both exercising the jurisdiction. State A is one whose space object is used for the purpose of astronaut going into the outer space. So, by virtue of personal jurisdiction, state A can exercise the jurisdiction over the astronaut. But state B, on the other hand, can also exercise the jurisdiction in this case, especially because of the reason that the astronaut is in the International Space Station and he is carrying on an activity therein. So a quasi-territorial jurisdiction is the connection for the purpose of exercising the jurisdiction by state B. The consequence is that there is a possibility that both state A and B may try to exercise the jurisdiction. State A may say that I have a personal jurisdiction, I will exercise the jurisdiction over the astronaut. B may say that I have a quasi-territorial jurisdiction, let me exercise the jurisdiction. On the contrary, both of them may point towards each other for the exercise of the jurisdiction. State A may point towards B to exercise, B may say A to exercise the jurisdiction. So therefore, even though Article 8 is unique, there are problems in the interpretation of Article 8 of the Outer Space Treaty regarding the jurisdiction and control. The next aspect is the principle of cooperation between the states. If we look into the five space treaties, the principle of cooperation between the states runs like a golden thread throughout the five space treaties. There are many provisions which reflect the principle of cooperation. To start with, in the Outer Space Treaty itself, Article 1, Article 3, and Article 9 generally speak about the different requirement of cooperation. Then Article 10, 11, and 12 specifically mention about certain cooperations, maybe in terms of actually allowing access to the observation of the space activities, giving information about the kind of activities being carried on, and also having access to the space object. All those different kind of things have been enumerated under Article 10, 11, and 12 of the Outer Space Treaty. Carrying forward this spirit of cooperation, we can find in the rescue agreement, the entire aspect of the emergency assistance to the astronauts and personnel, returning them back to the launching authority, or even collecting the space object and returning them back to the launching authority, all of them happen on the basis of cooperation between the states. The liability convention, despite the fact that it fixes the liability on launching state to pay compensation to the victim state, despite this, it is also based on cooperation between the states. Especially, we can find this cooperation in the dispute settlement. Liability convention provides its own mechanism through the diplomatic consultation, and if it fails, it also speaks about establishing a body called Claims Commission. And this Claims Commission consists of the representatives from the launching authority as well as from the victims, the state, and a third person jointly appointed by both of them together. So all these things require the cooperation for the purpose of settlement of disputes, even under the Liability Convention. Next, the Registration Convention, which also speaks about registration, also requires the cooperation by the states to take positive steps for going for the registration. And finally, the Moon Agreement, which also carried forward from the Outer Space Treaty, has got higher level of cooperation, whatever is required for extensive activities on the Moon and other celestial bodies. So that's why the cooperation between the states attains significance in almost all the space treaties. But despite this, unfortunately, cooperation between the states as a principle has failed in the space law, especially if we look into the Outer Space Treaty. Wordings are so vague regarding the cooperation that nobody can say what are the clear obligations on the states under the principle of cooperation between the states. Precisely because of that reason, many of the scholars have criticized the principle of cooperation enshrined in the space treaties, saying that it doesn't mean much, especially because it does not create a concrete obligations on the state. Finally, the last fundamental principle is the astronauts are envoys of the mankind. Article 5 of the Outer Space Treaty declares that astronauts are the envoys of the mankind. Or in other words, they are the representatives of the whole mankind. Of course, initial understanding was that there might be life in the outer space or celestial bodies. Whenever the astronauts go therein, they would interact with them as the representative of the whole mankind. So there was such kind of an understanding initially. There was another reason which is more significant than this. The astronauts who are going to the outer space were supposed to carry on certain scientific activities, or also supposed to carry on certain activities which are beneficial for everyone. So given that factor, it was presumed that the astronauts should be given a status of being the representatives of the whole mankind. So that was the understanding with which Article 5 has been incorporated. Article 5 and even the subsequent treaty, the rescue agreement, which supplements Article 5 of the Outer Space Treaty, they clearly provide certain provisions in terms of emergency assistance to the astronauts as well as personnel. Though Article 5 of the Outer Space Treaty mentioned only about astronauts, the rescue agreement carries this forward, this privilege forward, to the personnel, which is said to be a wider term than the astronaut. So any person who is assisting the astronauts in any of the missions, they would all come within the ambit of the definition of personnel. Under the rescue agreement, Articles 1 to 4 primarily deal with the obligation of state of unintended landing in case of an emergency with respect to the personnel. What they have to do, they have to notify to the launching authority, United Nations Secretary General, and they have to take immediate steps for the search and the rescue, and then they should also return them back safely to the launching authority. Article 5, on the other hand, speaks about obligations towards the space object. there is any unintended landing of the space object, then the state wherein the unintended landing has happened, it has to go for the collection and return only upon the request by the launching authority. Only if the launching authority requests. But whereas the personal is concerned, there is no requirement of even request from the launching authority. As an absolute obligation on the state of unintended landing to go search and rescue them and return them back to the launching authority. But in case of space object, only upon the request. And also in case of space object, whatever cost is incurred by the state of unintended landing, that has to be borne by the launching authority. The launching authority has to reimburse that particular cost. But whereas in case of personnel, there is no such kind of a provision for the cost reimbursement. So these are all the fundamental principles which have been enshrined in the space treaties. And also some of them have also attained the status of customary international law, even though there is a lot of debate amongst the scholars about which principle has attained or which principles have attained the status of customary international law. Now, the next significant aspect in the space law is the aspect of responsibility and liability. Before discussing the state responsibility and international liability under the space law, we need to understand two definitions. Definition of the launching state and state of registry. Launching state, as per Article 1C of the Liability Convention and 1A of the Registration Convention, both of them have the same definition, which say that launching state is a state which, number one, launches, number two, procures the launch. That is actually the, say for example, a state owns a satellite and it sends it across to another country for the purpose of launching. So the state which owns is procuring the launch in another country. Third, the state whose territory has been used. Fourth, the state whose facility has been used for the purpose of launching. So in other words, the definition of the launching state includes four different categories of the states. The one which actually launches, the second one, the state which procures the launching, third, the state whose territory has been used for the purpose of launch, and finally, the state whose facility has been used for the purpose of the launch. All these four categories of the states do come within the ambit of launching state. Of course, amongst these four categories also, multiple states may be there. For example, launching might be a joint launching. Several countries come together and launch. Even the procurement, the space object might belong to 10 different countries and they are procuring the launch in another country. Like that, so procurement also multiple states may come. So therefore, there is a possibility of in each category multiple states coming in. And in fact, under the space treaties, all these states which come within the ambit of the definition of the launching state would be considered as the joint launching states for a space object. They're all the joint launching state. So multiple states may be launching states with respect to a particular space object. But on the contrary, as the state of registry is concerned, Article 1C and Article 2 of the Registration Convention make it very clear that the state of registry is a state on whose registry the space object is carried in accordance with Article 2 of the Registration Convention. Article 1C says that it is the state on whose registry the space object is carried in accordance with Article 2. And Article 2, especially if we look into Article 2.2, it states that if there are multiple states, who are the launch, of course, it should be a launching state. Article 1C says that a launching state on whose registry the space object is carried in accordance with Article 2. That's the state of registry. So if there are multiple launching states, Article 2.2 says that they have to decide amongst themselves who is going to register the space object. In simple terms, there can be multiple launching states with respect to a space object, but there can be only one state of registry, which essentially needs to be a launching state. It's not possible that 10 countries launch a satellite together and make the 11th country as the state of registry. Not possible, especially because the state of registry needs to be a launching state. And being the launching state or the state of registry has got its own significance under the entire space law. There are multiple consequences coming out of a state being the state of registry or even the launching state. Now, with this backdrop, let me look into the responsibility and liability regime, which is most significant, especially in terms of the practical utility of the space law. In the Outer Space Treaty, we have two provisions on the responsibility and liability. Article 6 of the Outer Space Treaty speaks about the state responsibility, wherein it says that the state shall be, appropriate state shall be responsible for all activities in outer space, and they should also authorize and continuously supervise the space activities, whether carried on by the public entity or by the private entity. So in other words, the responsibility under the Outer Space Treaty is for both public activity as well as for the private space activities. Even the private entity's activities are attributable to the state, they are responsible under Article 7. Then Article 7 has a separate provision on international liability. It fixes the liability on the launching state. Article 7 clearly states that the launching state, the four different categories of the states whom I have already addressed, so they would all be liable for the payment of compensation if at all the damage has been caused out of their space activity. So the liability, it does not mention about the private player's liability, rather it speaks only about the liability of the launching state. The Liability Convention 1972, it extends the logic of Article 7 of the Outer Space Treaty, tries to elaborate on that, and also tries to provide a settlement mechanism within the ambit of this. Liability Convention makes a distinction between absolute liability and fault-based liability under Article 2 and Article 3. Even though Article 7 of the Outer Space Treaty does not make such a distinction, the Liability Convention makes a distinction between the two. Article 2 says that in the event of any damage being caused by the space object on the surface of the Earth or to the aircraft in flight, if the space object falls over a space aircraft which is in flight and causes damage to the aircraft, in those circumstances, launching state is absolutely liable to pay the compensation. The liability would be absolute liability. Of course, this is not the absolute liability as we understand in the Indian context. It is not N.C. Mehta case absolute liability, because Liability Convention provides an exception to this concept of absolute liability. Is not without any exception. Especially if we look into Article 6 of the Liability Convention, it speaks if at all the victim state is grossly negligent, or alternatively, it does an act or omission with an intention to cause damage, then the launching authority is not liable to pay the compensation to the victim state. So an exception is available under Article 6. Therefore, even though it is absolute liability, still it is subject to one exception as mentioned under Article 6. Liability Convention. Now, Article 3 speaks about the fault-based liability. And it comes into operation in the circumstances wherein there is a collision between two or more space objects, either in the airspace or in the outer space. It need not be only in outer space. So, if there are two or more space objects which collide, maybe in the airspace or in the outer space, in that circumstance, whoever is at fault, whichever launching authority is at fault, shall be liable to pay the compensation to the other state. That's what Article 3 says. So it's on the basis of the fault. But again, fault-based liability is very, very difficult to determine, especially the fault. If we look into the jurisprudential development, we decide on the basis of a so-called reasonable man test. Who is negligent, we would discuss on the basis, decide on the basis of the reasonable man test. And this reasonable man test is dependent on the repetitive practices. What has been done over the period of time and what is the standard, whether that particular standard has been followed or not. On that basis, the reasonable man test is applied. Unfortunately, in space activities, there is no such kind of repetitive practices. Every space activity is quite different, and we don't have actually any set standard or a particular kind of a space activity. So it becomes very, very difficult to prove who is at fault, who is negligent in case of any collision between two or more space objects, either in the airspace or maybe in the outer space. So that's why we don't find even a single case which has been decided under the fault-based liability till today. The Liability Convention also speaks about joint and several liability, which one can find under Article 4 as well as Article 5 in two different circumstances. Under Article 4, it says that if there is a collision between the two space objects belonging to two different countries, and this causes damage to a third state, maybe on the surface of the Earth or to the aircraft in flight, or maybe to a space object of a third state. In those circumstances, the first two shall be jointly and severally liable to the third state. That's what Article 4 says. Article 5 contemplates another situation. That is a situation of a space object belonging to the multiple launching states. Maybe 10 different states come together and launch a satellite, and this satellite falls over another country. In that circumstances, all the 10 launching states would be jointly and severally liable to pay the compensation to the victim state. That's what Article 5 basically speaks of. Apart from this fixation of liability, the Liability Convention also speaks about the settlement of disputes. As I've already pointed out, first of all, through the diplomatic consultation, they can settle the dispute. If at all it doesn't work out, then the Claims Commission has to be established. But the Claims Commission decision would be binding only if the parties agree in advance. Otherwise, it is only recommendatory in nature. Ultimately, one can move to the ICJ as well as a mechanism for the settlement of dispute. But at the same point of time, now we are also having the optional rules of the Permanent Court of Arbitration with respect to the space dispute. So one can go for that as well for the settlement of the dispute in the modern period. One of the instances wherein the limitation of the Liability Convention has been highlighted has been the Cosmos 954 incident. This is the incident wherein the erstwhile Soviet Union satellite Cosmos 954 fell over the Canadian territory. Cosmos had radioactive material. It is actually a satellite with a radioactive material on board it, actually. So it had a nuclear reactor on board the space object. When it fell over the Canadian territory, of course, it did not fall over the populated area. It was in a barren the place that actually it fell over. The debris of that, because once it re-entered into the Earth's atmosphere, it started burning. So it became fragmented. And these debris are scattered over different places in Canada. Canada had to carry on extensive search operation for the purpose of the neutralizing the radioactive materials. It had to collect all those debris, and then subsequently it had to be neutralized, especially few of them were considered to be, were found to be lethal. So consequently, they had to go for extensive search operation. Now, after all these operations, Canada claimed compensation from the Soviet Union. Compensation primarily for the purpose of expenses, whatever they have incurred in terms of collecting those radioactive materials and neutralizing them. So for that purpose, whatever expenditure, of course, because it's an operation of around 8 months, so therefore they have spent a lot of money for the purpose of recovery as well as the neutralizing of the radioactive materials. They now claim compensation from Soviet Union. Interestingly, even though Soviet Union paid some compensation on ex gratia basis, not accepting the liability, it did not accept the liability under the Liability Convention. It is very interesting to note that if we look into the Liability Convention, Soviet Union was not actually liable to pay compensation. This is because we have a very, very weak definition of the damage under Article 1A of the Liability Convention. It has a very, very restricted definition. Article 1A says that damage for the purpose of this convention includes loss of life, impairment of the health, or damage or any kind of a loss of the property. It speaks only about the damage to the property. In other words, it covers only the actual damage, whatever has happened. Maybe loss of life, impairment of health, or loss or damage to the property. Whereas in Cosmos 954, Canada did not have such kind of a loss. It was not that it fell over a property and the property became damaged out of that, or maybe fell over people and consequently the people were injured. Rather, this is a situation where the debris have fallen over the Canadian territory, and if at all it has been left unattended, it would have emitted the radiation and could have caused the damage to the Canadian environment. So they have to take preventive measures or the precautionary measures to eliminate any possible danger or harm posed by the radioactive materials. And unfortunately, Article 1A does not include that within the ambit of its definition. So therefore, Soviet Union was definitely not liable to pay compensation under the Liability Convention. Fortunately for Canada, some amount was paid by USSR, which is half the amount which has been claimed by Canada. But still, Canada happily accepted that compensation because it knew that it is not possible to fix the liability on Soviet Union under the Liability Convention. That is why Liability Convention is quite limited, and there is a requirement of actually updating the Liability Convention depending on the current requirements. Now, another important aspect in terms of liability is that even though we have got extensive private space activities, still under the Liability Convention, launching state is liable to pay the compensation. There is no mention about the liability of the private players. It's only the launching state which is liable to pay the compensation. That is why, in order to shift the burden of this liability, some kind of the developments have taken place in the spacefaring nations, wherever the private space players have come into existence, wherein they have gone for the space insurance. In the process of licensing the private players, they insist for the minimum insurance, the procurement, so that in the event of any kind of a damage caused by the private space activity, the compensation can come from the space insurance instead of the state incurring the liability to pay the compensation. So this is all about the state responsibility and the international liability under the space law. The next aspect is the aspect of registration. The registration of the space object is very, very significant for the purpose of identification of the space object. And this identification is again important for four reasons. One, that under Article 8 of the Outer Space Treaty, it is the state of registry which should exercise the jurisdiction and control over the space object. Second, under the Liability Convention, it is the launching state which shall be liable to pay the compensation. Of course, it does not say state of registry is solely liable to pay the compensation. It says launching state. But state of registry, as I have already pointed out, need to be at least one of the launching states. It need to be one of the launching states. So once the state knows who is the state of registration, of course, the victim state can claim the compensation against that state. And that state cannot reject to pay the full amount, especially because of the joint and several liability. All states are jointly and severally liable, so therefore the full amount has to be paid by the concerned state. So therefore, at least one of the launching states can be identified with the help of the registration. Third, with respect to the return of the space objects, again, if we look into the Outer Space Treaty, return of the astronaut has to be done to the state of registration. That's what Outer Space Treaty says. And if we look into the rescue agreement, it says the return has to be done to the launching authority. Space object or maybe personal has to be returned back to the launch authority. This can also be identified with the help of registration, which is the launching authority, which we can identify with the help of registration. Finally, fourth major reason for the identification or the registration is that in case of a space inventions or maybe infringement of a patent in the outer space or in the celestial bodies, in both circumstances, both exercise of the jurisdiction as well as applicable law can be determined with the help of registration. So whoever is the registering state, they may exercise the jurisdiction and their laws, municipal laws, patent laws may be made applicable for the purpose of dealing with the infringement of patents. Because of all these reasons, registration becomes crucial. And we have a separate convention, the Registration Convention of 1975. It speaks about dual registration, one in the national registry. Article 2 says that soon after a space object has been launched into the Earth orbit or beyond, it has to be registered in the national registry by the launching authority. 2.2 says that if there are multiple launching states, one of them have to go for registration, not all of them. Next, Article 3 and 4 speak about the registration in the UN registry. Article 3 says that the UN Secretary General need to maintain a separate registry at the international level. And Article 4 speaks about the information which need to be furnished by the states. There are different information like the launching state or launching states, date of launch, place of launch, the particular actually the designation of the space object or the name of a space object, then orbital parameters, all those things, information about that has to be furnished to the Secretary General for the purpose of the registration in the International Registry. So in the event of any disaster, one can basically look into the International Registry and find out which is the launching authority with respect to that particular. But again, there may be certain circumstances wherein the space object which has fallen over the third country might be fragmented and it might not be possible to identify to which state it belongs. In those cases, Article 6 of the Registration Convention says that the states which are capable of identifying the space object due to their tracking facilities or maybe any other advanced technology, they should be helping other states with respect to identifying the space object. That's what the Registration Convention says about the registration, identification of the space object, as well as helping out other countries in terms of finding out which is the launching authority. This is all about the general principles which have been developed, or maybe general norms which have been developed with respect to the space law in the international level. One last thing which I would like to say before concluding this first part of the lecture is about the national space laws. With the increase in the private space activities, what has happened is that there is a requirement of regulating these private activities. International treaties, the five major space treaties, whatever we have discussed, all of them came into existence at the time when the states were the sole players in the outer space. It's all the state-oriented space activities which was going on in 1960s or 1970s. Therefore, the space treaties only mentioned about the regulation of the state activities in outer space, and they didn't mention much about the private space activities. Of course, only provision is Article 6, which speaks about the authorization and continued supervision by the concerned state about the private activities. Apart from that, nothing else has been mentioned in any of the space treaties. With the increased private space activities, it became absolutely essential for the states to regulate these private space activities. Otherwise, they would incur the responsibility and liability for these private activities. That is why the states have started developing the national space legislation. In the international level, no other treaty is forthcoming. Therefore, the national space legislation has started to come in different countries. But as of now, only a handful of the states have already developed the national space legislation, not many. And amongst them, we can find that there are two kinds of approaches. One is a kind of a completely commerce-oriented approach, wherein those countries would like to promote commercial space activities as much as possible, and they don't want to regulate the private space activities. They would like to promote more and more. So given that factor, they're trying to bring out a kind of an environment which is conducive for more and more space activities without much regulation. We can find this kind of development happening in the United States, or even for that matter in Australia. They are all commerce-oriented approaches. But on the contrary, we have some states which have tried to develop the laws on the basis of balancing the fundamental space law principles with that of the commercial interest of the private players. They are trying to balance between the two sides. But I'm not saying that actually it's a perfect balance which they are trying to have. But of course, they are trying to incorporate certain fundamental space law principles which are developed in the 20th century in their national legislation. I should say that both Russian legislation as well as UK legislation to a greater extent try to strike a balance between the fundamental space law principles as well as the commercial interest of the private players. So therefore, we can find that on the one hand, complete commerce-oriented approach, and on the other hand, somewhat balanced approach is the kind of approach which is taking shape in the development of the national space legislation. Since there are diversified approaches in different countries, International Law Association started to think in terms of having harmonization. And precisely because of this reason, ILA has come up with the model law, ILA model law on the national space legislation. Of course, it has tried to codify some of the very, very fundamental aspects which need to be there in the national space legislation. But at the same point of time, it is not a foolproof model law. It is having its own limitations. There are many aspects which are missing out in the model law, and some of them are also not dealt appropriately under the model law. But whatever it may be, the model law is intended to ensure that there is a kind of a harmonization. There is no complete diversification in terms of the development of the international space legislation in different countries. Finally, if we look into the Asian responses, at the Asian level, there is only one country which has developed the comprehensive space laws, that is the Republic of Korea. It has got comprehensive legislation in terms of the space activities and regulating the space activities and even fixation of liability. But apart from Republic of Korea, we don't find any other Asian country passing the national space legislation, even though we are all trying hard for the purpose of enacting the national space legislation. India has been trying to do this since the beginning of the 21st century. And even in 2017, there was a draft national space legislation bill, which has also been actually prepared. And it has also been actually opened for the public comment. But till today, it has not been adopted. We are still trying to fine-tune it and to come up with actually a better legislation for the purpose of regulating the private space activities in India. So this is all briefly about the entire gamut of the space law. I should say that actually it is in nutshell. It's not that actually in detail I could able to analyze, because it is primarily with the time limitation. I could able to put forward actually a framework of the space law, both in the international as well as the national level. The remaining aspect in terms of the practical utilization or the practical significance of space law, I will deal it in the second part.